Hello students, today we discuss about the unit 3, mechanical properties of material. This chapter is divided into 4 parts of PPT. The first part is today, introduction to mechanical properties of material, and second PowerPoint is strengthening and material, strengthen material and grip resistance. And third PowerPoint is fracture and fatigue property, and fourth one will be harness testings. So this chapter is divided into 4 PowerPoint presentations. So today we discuss about the first PowerPoint presentation is introduction to mechanical properties of material. So already you know that various materials are used in various devices such as aircraft, spacecraft, marine craft, automobile device, machine. So these materials are special mechanical property for best performance. So already you know that mechanical property is nothing but elasticity. So elasticity means after removing the deforming forces, the material regain the original position is called elasticity. Plasticity means after removing the deforming forces, the material do not regain the original shape is called plasticity. Ductility means the materials are converted into thin or wire without any bending. Such property is called ductility. So these are the important or structural designing property. Some important measurable parameters are elastic modulus. Already you know the modulus. There are 3 different type of modulus: Young's modulus, bulk modulus, rigidity modulus. It is otherwise called stiffness constant. Ultimate tensile strength means UTS. Yield strength means OS. Hardness, toughness. So these are the some important measurable parameters. So already you know that stress strain curve. It is already discussed in properties of matter semester 1. Strain means change in dimension by original dimension. Stress means restoring forces per unit area. So strain along x axis, stress along y axis. When a graph is plotted between the stress and strain, we get this type of graph. So stress is increases, strain also increases up to the region OA. OA is called proportional to limit or linear region. So in this region we draw a slope. The slope and we can find out the stiffness constant. Stiffness constant is nothing but modulus. There are 3 different type of modulus can be find out. Again, stress, this linear region is obey Hooke's law. Already you know Hooke's law. Within the elastic limit, stress produced by the body is directly proportional to the strain. Such it is called Hooke's law. Again, the stress is increases, strain also increases to reach the point B. So B is called upper yield stress point. Again, the stress is increases, the curve go to the point C. C is called lower yield point. Again, the stress is increases, strain increases enormously to reach the point D. So CD is called plastic behavior. So D is called ultimate tensile strength. So maximum stress obtained in this graph is called ultimate tensile strength. And again, the stress is increases, the curve can go to the point E. E is called breaking stress or fracture. Breaking stress or fracture. Okay. So then the resilience means the ability of the material to absorb the energy within the elastic limit, that is the triangular area of the curve, is called resilience. If the plastic deformation observed when you're loading beyond the elastic limit, most of the material undergo the plastic deformation beyond the settled stress is called yield strength. Beyond the yield strength, the stress versus strain curve is non-linear. Non-linear region is called plastic region. Now we discuss about the difference between the ductile material and the brittle material. Material which fracture after considerable plastic deformation is called ductile material. The material which remain perfectly elastic up to fracture are called brittle material. Tensile strength is the maximum stress in the stress strain diagram is called tensile strength. Ductility means the ability of the material to deform the plastically under tensile load. Toughness, it is the material, ability of the material to observe the energy up to fracture. It is an area under the stress strain curve and expressed as a energy per unit volume. And we can define some important two marks present in the stress strain diagram. Ultimate tensile strength, it is the maximum stress that the material can withstand or without fracture. Elastic limit, maximum limit up to which the body obey the elastic behavior is called elastic limit. After the elastic limit, the body will be in the limit is called plastic limit. Safety factor, it is the ratio of ultimate tensile stress to their working stress is called safety factor. Elastic fatigue, if the body is continuously applied to the stress or strain, the body becomes weak. It is called elastic fatigue. Breaking stress or fracture stress means if the stress at which the failure takes place is called breaking stress or working stress, even a very small load beyond the ultimate tensile strength, the material will be broken. That is called breaking stress. Malleability means the ability of the material to deform plastically under compressible load. So next we discuss about the tensile stress. Already you know the tensile strength, it is the maximum stress in the stress strain diagram. So the test can be performed by the ductile material. So various parameter can be determined: limit of proportionality, yield point, yield strength, maximum tensile strength, breaking strength, percentage of elongation, percentage of reduction area, modulus of elasticity. So this all the parameters can be determined by tensile stress. So tensile stress usually measured by UTM machine, universal testing machine. So this type of instrument are present in our metallurgical lab, particularly mechanical department. Tensile stress is the fundamental test in metallurgy. It is to find the tensile properties such as yield strength, ultimate strength, elasticity, etc. So next we discuss about the UTM principle. So ductile material is gradually increasing the load. It gets plastically deformed and finally break. So this is the principle of the UTM. During the plastic deformation, changes takes place the cross-sectional area and length. The area will be 12.5 millimeter specimen diameter and the gauge length will be 50 millimeters. Then what is the testing procedure? The testing procedure, so now we explain the testing procedure. Now the load is gradually on the specimen. First we take the specimen, the two end of the jaws, and then load is applied gradually of the specimen by means of movable cross head till the specimen fracture. During the testing, the magnitude, the load is measured by the load measuring unit, that is load cell. A strain gauge or extenometer is used to measure the elongation of the specimen between the gauge mark. Then the different values of load and elongations at a different interval are recorded and tabulated. So what are the results are obtained from the tensile stress? So if A0 is the original cross-sectional area and AF is the final cross-sectional area of the neck, L0 is the original length of the specimen, LF is the final length of the specimen, therefore the limit of proportionality is proportional limit load by A0. Elastic limits equal to elastic limit load by original cross-sectional area, and yield point stress is yield load at yield point by original cross-sectional area. Ultimate tensile stress equal to maximum load by original cross-sectional area. Modulus of elasticity means stress by strain. Percentage of elongation means that is LF. LF means final length of the specimen minus original length of the specimen by original length of the specimen into 100. Percentage of reduction in area is A0 minus AF. That is original cross-sectional area minus final cross-sectional area by original cross-sectional area into 100. So by using the formula, we can find out the various ductile parameters. That is yield strength, ultimate tensile strength, percentage of elongation, percentage of reduction in area, modulus of elasticity. So yield strength is used to estimate the shearing strength. Ultimate tensile strength is degree of work hardening that has occurred. Percentage of elongation indicate material ductility and toughness. Percentage of reduction in area indicate material ductility and toughness. Modulus of elasticity to measure the relative stiffness of the materials. Then deformations. So deformation means The force or stress acting on a material or object, the object changes the shape. That is called deformation. There are two different type of deformation. Elastic deformation. Elastic deformation means the force or stress acting on a material, the body changes the shape. After removing the forces, it comes to the original position. It's called elastic deformation. So this is the diagram representation. So it is the original position. The stress force are acting on a object. The object changes the shape. Again, the stress or force is removed. It comes to the original position. Again, plastic deformation. So plastic deformation means after removing the deforming forces, the metal pieces does not regain the original shape. Is called plastic deformation. So it depends upon applied stress, temperature, and strain rate. It is affected in both internal and external state. So these are the plastic deformation diagram. So it is the original position. After applying the stress or force, it changes the shape. Again, to removing the forces, it does not recover the original positions. The plastic deformation mechanism has a main important role in the mechanical property. So it depends upon the orientation of the crystal with respect to the stress direction. And the tensile force is applied to a crystal in a certain direction, the crystal tends to slip along a certain preferred atomic planes. So here, first slip, the process by which the plastic deformation is produced by the dislocation motion in terms of slips, or one part of the crystal moves from another part of the certain plane, is called another slip. And a slip plane is a plane surface through a crystal along which slip can take place under some condition without abruptly disturbing the crystal. So next will be slip mechanism. So there are four different type of slip mechanism. Perfect crystal without slip, and first diagram represented by without slip, and a deforming forces or shearing force is applied to the crystal. The slip takes place along the slip plane. Permanent deformation and the deforming forces are removed. The combination of slip plane and slip direction is known as slip system. Then single crystal system. So there is a direction of the force, there is a direction of the slip plane. Direction of the slip plane. So small step of the slip on the surface is parallel to one another. That is a slip will be occur in various type of crystal structure, BCC, FCC, HCP. So BCC, 110 plane, and 1 bar 1 1 is the slip direction. Number of slip system is 12, and the FCC system 111 plane, slip direction is 1 1 bar 0, 4 into 3 12 slip system. HCP 0 0 0 1 1 1 2 bar 0 1 into 3 3 number of slip system. Then critical resolved shearing stress, that is the extent of slip depends upon the magnitude of the produced external load and the geometrical of the crystal structure. The orientation of the active slip with respect to the shearing stresses. Slip begins when the shearing stress on the slip plane in the slip direction attain a threshold value, is called critical resolved shearing stress. So consider a crystal area A, tensile force is acting. So due to the forces, crystal to get sheared along in the slip plane of area A, if the shearing stress is resolved in the direction exceed to a certain critical value. So this is a diagram representations. That is the crystal A, force, slip direction, and a resolved series Fs by As. Then pi is the angle between F and the slip direction. Theta is the angle between F and the normal to the slip plane. Tensile stress is sigma equal to F by A. Area of the slip plane inclined at an angle is A dash equal to A by cos theta. Shearing force in the slip direction Fs is due to the tensile force is given by Fs equal to F cos pi. The shearing stress in the slip direction is tau equal to Fs by A dash. That is F cos pi cos theta by A. That is a tau equal to sigma cos pi by cos theta. So this equation is called Schmidt factors. The stress required at a certain temperature to initiate the slip in a pure single crystal material is constant. So this is known as Schmidt's law. So next will be role of dislocation in slip. Already you know that crystal defect, that is the missing of atom in a crystal plane is called crystal defect, or missing of atom or molecule are called crystal defect. There are various type of crystal defects, are zero dimensional, one dimensional, two dimensional, three dimensional. So here we discuss about the one dimensional defect is called line defect or dislocations. The defect takes place due to the dislocation or distortion of atom along the line in some direction is called line defect. There are two different type of line defect, edge dislocation and other will be screw dislocation. In edge dislocation, a portion of the line atom is missing or displaced from a regular site. So in screw dislocation is due to the one part of the crystal related to the another part of the crystal. So this is the role of the slip, dislocation slip. Initial position of the extra half plane of the atom, plane A, when the shearing stress is applied to the plane A, forced to move the left. Similarly, the top half of plane B and C, D move in the same direction. The applied stress is sufficient magnitude and the interatomic bonds of the plane is broken along the shearing plane. Thus, the upper half of the plane B becomes the extra half plane and plane A link up with the bottom half of the plane B. So, this process is repeated by the other plane. Therefore, the extra half plane move from right to left by shifting the upper plane. So the process by which the plastic deformation is produced by the dislocation motion is called slip. Next we discuss about the tunning. So tunning is a special type of grain boundary. So it is separated by the two crystalline region. One will be the mirror image of the parent atom. So in one side, the atom on one side, the plane location in the mirror image position of the atom on the other side. The crystallographic plane of symmetry being the deformed and the undeformed parts of a metal lattice is called tunning planes. So this is the tunning planes. It is the parent atom, this is the mirror image of the atom. Two different type of tunes. One will be mechanical tunes. Mechanical tunes are deformed by the mechanical deformation. It will be takes place by BCC metal, HCP metal under the condition of decreased temperature and shock loading. Annealing tunes means takes place by annealing process. It will be takes place by FCC metal and a border. So there is a difference between slip and a tunning. It's a shearing deformation that moves atom by many interatomic distance in one crystal plane over the atom of another crystal is called slip. Similar tunning means that is a crystal takes place the orientation which takes place the portion of the mirror image of the parent crystal. In slip, multiple atomic spacing. In tunning, atom movement are much lesser than the atomic spacing. The orientation of the crystal above and below the slip plane is the same after and before deformation. Orientation difference takes place across the tuned plane. It occurs over wide plane. Every atomic plane is involved. It takes place several milliseconds. It takes place in few milliseconds. Slip planes disappear after grinding. Twin planes run through the whole depth of the material and hence do not disappear on grinding, etc. So thank you for listening. Any question, please.